morning, Chalice congregation, and welcome to our service this morning, Easter Day. Please join in singing our welcoming song when it comes around.
Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united by our desire to grow in love and in service. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are with us for the first time this morning, we're glad you're here. I'm David Peel, the worship associate today. Our service is led by our minister, Reverend Sharon Wylie. Our worship musician this morning is Mr. Tim McKnight. Our song leaders are Patty Carlisle and Tom Carlstrom. Our tech team is Hope Campbell and Sarah Komnick. And our greeters this morning as you came in were Kevin Kong and Anne McKiernan. Welcome to our Sunday morning worship. Welcome to those of you here in the chapel, and welcome to those of you watching live using Zoom. For those of us here in the chapel, you'll notice and as a newcomer, you might be interested in the groups and activities we have to offer. A good way to get this information is through our email and newsletter, our e-news calendar. Online newcomers, you will receive an email invitation to join our email list after the service. In-person newcomers, if you haven't already given us your email when you signed in this morning, please share it with us before you leave. Our weekly email is the best way to get information about the many groups and activities we have to offer here at Chalice. Yeah, now let's take a breath together.
we begin our service by acknowledging that wherever each of us is watching, if we are in what is now called the United States, then we are on land stolen from indigenous peoples. Our congregational home in what We begin our service by acknowledging that wherever each of us is watching, if we are in what is now called the United States, then we are on land stolen from indigenous peoples. Our congregational home in what is now called Escondido is on land that is part of the traditional territories of the 12 bands of the Kumeyaay Nation and the 7 bands of the Payam-Kuwichum, also called Luiseno. Land that is sacred to us now was stolen from people for whom that land was and is still sacred. In recognition that we are the beneficiaries of a history of colonization, we have made financial donations in the past year to 2 local indigenous-led organizations, Kumeyaay Community College and the Palma After School Program for K-12 students. It is our hope at Chalice to find our way to right relationship with local tribes.
Now we light our chalice, the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith. I'd like to invite Patty Carlisle to light our chalice this morning. Our chalice lighting words this morning. Much of the world celebrates Easter today. Happy Easter. Easter celebrates that mysterious event when the entombed body of Christ was found to have disappeared from the tomb, the entrance of which had been blocked by a rather large boulder. These days, the world may not seem as mysterious as it once must have seemed. From our privileged place in history, we can now see the world as a causal place. The blotting out of the sun in the middle of the day is a simple consequence of celestial mechanics. Devastating shaking of the solid ground of Earth is simply the release of stress built up by sliding of incomprehensibly large floating rafts of earth, a la plate tectonics. The shimmering, colorful lights in the northern winter night sky are not spirits dancing, but ionized atoms recoiling from atoms thrown off by our thermonuclear sun. Where's the mystery in all of that? The mystery is still there. Causal is not exclusive of mystery, awe, or wonder. We light this chalice and see the simple light of a candle. May we still feel the mystery of that small light that touches and connects each of us. Thank you.
Happy Easter. Also, happy Transgender Day of Visibility today. Yay. The words of our call to worship come from the Reverend Elizabeth Strong, she of blessed memory. Out of the earth rises light, rises life, rises spring. May we join with the miracle that is springtime and enter into life with lightness and joy. Out of the spirit rises faith, rises hope, rises love. May we join with the miracle that is Easter time and enter into life with hope and love. Let us resurrect with spring. Let us resurrect with the Spirit and enter into renewed life as we gather into our time of worship together this Easter morning. Will you join in singing?
We will be singing hymn number 61, Lo, the Earth Awakes Again.
The earth shall be made new. be seated.
As hopefully most of you know, we have started to Let Your Love Flow pledge campaign. There are many ways to let your love flow at Chalice, from being a greeter, to singing in the choir, to working to get solar installed on our new hub building. But none of this can happen without the financial commitment of each of us. Today, we celebrate those who have already pledged this week or who can make a pledge today. If you need a form to write down your pledge, raise your hand and one will be brought to you. I don't see any. Okay. And now, we invite these early bird pledgers to come forward. We will sing Let Your Love Flow with special words written by John Schultz. Come on down.
Like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams, and let your love show. And you'll know what I mean, it's the season to let your love fly like a bird on the wind, and let your love bind you to all living things, and let your love shine. And you'll know what I mean, it's the reason. It's the reason. Just let your love flow like a mountain stream, and let your love grow with the smallest of dreams. And let your love show, and you'll know what I mean, it's the season to let your love fly like a bird on the wind, and let your love bind you to all living things, and let your love shine, and you'll know what I mean, it's the reason. It's the reason.
Our Sunday worship is the shared spiritual practice of our community, and we tend to the congregation during this time by sharing and honoring our joys and sorrows. Here in the chapel, you are welcome to write your joy or sorrow onto a candle card, which will be collected from you. Online, please write your joy or sorrow in the chat box. These joys and sorrows will be spoken out loud, and then we will remove this part of the service from the recording that goes onto our YouTube channel, so this sharing won't be publicly available online. We have a few minutes of music, so you can write down what you would like to share. If you'd like to send Reverend Sharon a confidential note about your joy or sorrow, or to make a prayer request, please email her, and her email address will be on the screen in a moment. Thank you.
bride. Now I think we've named our joys and sorrows. So we'll light a final pillar candle for all the joys and sorrows in the room and in our community that may go unshared and unspoken this morning. These too are held in the love and support of our community. And now I'd like to invite the children and anyone else who would like to come up front to hear a telling of the
Story of Easter by Eileen Fisher, illustrated by Stefano Vital. Easter is a time of rejoicing. It comes in spring, when the cold, dark days of winter are over. Birds return to sing. Grass and flowers begin to make a new carpet for the earth. For Christians, Easter Sunday is the greatest holiday of the year. It is a day of joy. It celebrates the resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth, who rose from death to new life many years ago. Almost everyone knows something about the life of Jesus. As a boy, he lived in the small town of Nazareth, near the Sea of Galilee, in what is now northern Israel. When he was about 30 years old, he began teaching and preaching and healing the sick. His fame spread quickly, and soon he had 12 disciples or followers. They went with Jesus and learned from him as he walked through the countryside talking to the people. Crowds gathered to hear Jesus preach. Many people began to say that he was the Savior, or Messiah, they had long been waiting for. Early one spring, Jesus and his disciples walked the long, rough road to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, the holiday on which Jews celebrate their liberation from slavery in Egypt. On a mild Sunday morning, Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. People cheered and waved branches of palm trees to welcome him. They spread palm branches before him. In honor of this day, Christians celebrate Palm Sunday, the first day of Holy Week. Often palm branches, or crosses made of palm leaves, are given out at church services. After that first Palm Sunday, Jesus preached in the outer halls of the great temple at Jerusalem for several days. People crowded around to listen and to praise him. But he had enemies, too. The authorities accused Jesus of breaking laws. They were afraid that he was gaining too much power over the people. On Thursday evening, Jesus ate the Passover supper with his 12 disciples. During the meal, he rose from the table, took a basin of water, and began to wash the feet of his disciples. Jesus did this to show he was willing to be a servant to those who followed him. We now call this meal the Last Supper and the day Maundy Thursday. For many years, the chief ceremony on Maundy Thursday was washing the feet of poor people. Today, people often give Maundy money to the needy as well. In honor of this bread and wine that Jesus and his disciples shared at the Passover meal, many Christians celebrate the Eucharist, or Communion, on Maundy Thursday. This is also a traditional day for First Communions and joining the church. After washing the feet of his disciples, Jesus led them to a large garden outside the walls of Jerusalem to spend the night. Toward morning, Judas, one of the 12, led a band of temple guards to the garden. They seized Jesus. After a hearing, the authorities found Jesus guilty of stirring up the people and speaking against the things they held sacred. The Roman rulers sentenced him to death by crucifixion, as was common for political prisoners at that time. So Jesus was taken to a hill outside Jerusalem and nailed to a cross. Because of this, the cross is one of the most important symbols of the Christian religion. This happened on a Friday morning, a day we now call Good Friday, or God's Friday. For Christians, it is a day of sadness. Many churches hold a service in the afternoon with short sermons about the last words Jesus spoke from the cross. Before the sun went down on that first Good Friday, friends of Jesus took his lifeless body from the cross. They laid it on a stone in a stone tomb and rolled a great stone before the door. At sunrise on Sunday morning, Mary Magdalene and two other women went to the tomb. The big stone had been rolled away. They looked into the tomb and saw a young man dressed in a white robe. "Do not be amazed," he said to them. "Jesus is risen. He is not here." The women ran to tell the news to the disciples. They remembered then that, while they were still in Galilee, Jesus had told them he would be crucified. And he had also told them, "After 3 days I will rise again." This was the third day. On that first Easter Sunday, Jesus appeared to the disciples. He told them to go back to Galilee. He said, "Go into all the world and preach the good news." The disciples understood that Jesus wanted them to spread the good news of his resurrection and to teach others what he had taught them. And that is how the Christian church was started. The date of Easter is not the same from year to year. Most people celebrate on the first Sunday after the first full moon in spring. But Orthodox Christians use a different date. They celebrate Easter on the Sunday following Passover. Long before the celebration of Easter began, people celebrated a spring festival. They danced and gave gifts. They rejoiced over the rebirth of life in the fields and woodlands. After the Christian religion spread to many lands, the joy of Jesus' resurrection became mingled with the joy of the spring festival. Both celebrations stood for new life. Both stood for new hope in the hearts of people. And so it is not strange that many of the customs of the old spring festival became part of our celebrations of Easter. On Easter Sunday, millions of Christians attend outdoor services, often on a hill where they can see the sunrise. There is an old saying that the sun dances as it rises on Easter morning. Inside the churches, Easter lilies bloom in front of the altars. People lift up their voices and sing. Not all Christian churches celebrate the Easter season in the same way, but the message of Easter is always the same. It is the joy and celebration of the belief that God's love is stronger than death.
Easter story.
We will now sing the children out.
Walk on your path with a song so sweet, that everywhere you go, there is love all around. Walk on your path with a song so sweet, that everywhere you go, there is love all around.
For that. That was the most memorable part of Easter. They shot confetti over our heads. So I know that we have a lot of different, folks have a lot of different relationships to Christianity and to the Easter story in the room. Some of us didn't grow up Christian, and we're all going to have a range of reactions to the story, but probably those of us who didn't grow up in Christianity don't have too much emotion attached to the story. We might have curiosity or distaste, right? It's a story of a man being crucified. Some of you came to Unitarian Universalism as part of a rejection of the Christianity that you grew up in and might have a range of reactions from sort of maybe nostalgia or some, you know, that's a memory, something from your past, to feelings of hurt or anger. The story of Jesus' suffering has been used at times to excuse human suffering. And, you know, that story can be told in lots of different ways to scare us. And then some of you will have come to Unitarian Universalism and have Christian beliefs that are part of your Unitarian Universalism. So this story might have special meaning, and you will likely have insights and feelings about it that some of the rest of us don't have. So, you know, the same way that we explore and mark other holidays of the year, this is an important one. You know, over 2 billion people in the world are Christian. And I think I want to encourage us this morning not to dismiss the story, but to feel curious about what is its meaning and impact to so many people. It's not the only story of Christianity. Of course, some faith traditions emphasize it more than others. But I think something that's so meaningful and important to so many people is worthy of our attention and reflection on what might people get from that story. And in particular this morning, as we think about a story that we want to maybe make sense of, be in relationship with, you know, I think we can do hard work trying to like make sense of a story like that. And I want to encourage us to hold it a little more lightly as a story that holds mystery and whose meaning we may not understand fully. Religious traditions, spiritual teachings aren't meant to be easily or fully understood. And part of our work as spiritual people is to live in that mysterious space and not to try maybe to put everything into words, but to let ourselves, you know, what is our feeling when we consider that story and different pieces of it. I imagine that many of us have had times in our lives where we felt that sense of things dying, whether it was sort of literally someone we love dying, something that is important to us that we had to let go of, something changing in our lives, maybe not fully in our control, and have had feelings of hopelessness and uncertainty about how to go forward and, you know, what will be on the other side of our grief or our loss. And I think for me, that's one of the mysteries of the resurrection story, to reflect on those times where we felt like we can't see a way forward, and it feels like we're losing everything. And this story lifts up that there is still hope on the other side, that someone, you know, suffered and was reborn. And I imagine many of us have had times in our lives where we have felt renewed, or like we got through something we hadn't been clear that we'd be able to get through. I would never, I hope you know, and encourage you not to, I would never say to anyone that everything happens for a reason or God doesn't give you more than you can handle. I don't think those are helpful platitudes. And it is also true that many of us have experienced that we make it through hard times, that we learn to carry our grief a little lighter, that we have moments of feeling like we can't go on, and yet the day comes that we're able to laugh again or enjoy a beautiful day or beautiful music. And that's one, to me, one of life's great mysteries. Not so dependable that you can rely on it. Some people don't make it through their hard moments. But it is still one of the cycles of life, that we have times of loss and then feeling restored and re-enlivened again. And we see that mirrored also in the movement of the natural world. I think the metaphor on the nature side of things is composting, right? Plants die. Not just that spring brings new life, but plants die, and from that, you know, the humus of compost can encourage new life and new growth. So that's one way that I think about the resurrection story and how we see it in our own lives. When Jesus was reborn, resurrected, he wasn't immediately recognizable to those who had loved him. There are stories of him appearing to Mary, appearing to the disciples, and they don't recognize him right away. And I think for me, there's a truth and a mystery there as well. Those of us who are lucky have lives of continuous or almost continuous growth and learning, and get to experience what it's like to transform, to continue sort of evolve and expanding what we know and who we are. And we can become unrecognizable, not just to our loved ones, but even ourselves when we live through something. I'll remind us, we're still coming out of pandemic times, and we've been changed in ways we may not even fully understand about ourselves yet. And we may be getting to know ourselves all over again. What do we like to do? What's comforting? What's nourishing? Those things may have changed. So, you know, sort of the truth and the mystery of transformation and what it is to continually be learning ourselves anew. I hear that in part of that story. And then when you think about, you know, the way that I envisioned God when I was little, and we didn't go, I was told we were Christian, but we went to church once a year, Easter. So that was my grandmother's religion. But I had a book of children's Bible stories. And, you know, I really pictured God as like the old man in the sky. That's sort of my youngest conception of God. Old man with a white beard who judged us and sort of cared whether or not we murdered people or whether or not we observed the Sabbath, right? This like sort of range of serious infractions. So that was a very distant, not easy to understand God. And when you think of the story of Jesus as a God who came down here and suffered, lived with humans, suffered with humans, fought against empire, fought against injustice, died from injustice, and then was resurrected, then made it through the seeming end of life at death to another side and a promise of a hopeful and wonderful life on the other side of hardship. That's a very different vision of God and one that's deeply moving and comforting to people. I don't consider myself Christian, but even in my low moments, I think of a God who weeps with me, who suffers with me. That's a very different feeling than that distant God in the sky. So, you know, I think there's many parts of the Easter story to feel curious about, to maybe invite in and reflect on where you meet that story and how it might have meaning for you. But however you engage with the Jesus resurrection story, I hope that this time of year is a reminder that new life is always possible and growing in us. And that when we do have hard times and challenges to face, we can have some faith that it's possible to make it through to the other side of that challenge and grief and hardship. May it be so. Amen.
Please rise in body or spirit and join in singing hymn number 123, Spirit of Life, and we will sing it through two times.
Rise in the sea.
The Sunday offering is an expression of generosity that makes our congregational life possible. Lao Tzu teaches in the Tao Te Ching, the master has no possessions. The more he does for others, the happier he is. The more she gives to others, the wealthier she is. Please text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, once you text that amount, you'll get a reply back with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. If you've already entered this information on a prior donation, you won't have to enter that information again. If your Sunday donation is meant to be part of your pledge payment, please be sure to indicate pledge after the dollar amount. The phone number for text donations will be on screen in a moment. And if you prefer to make an in-person donation of cash or check, there are envelopes and a donation box over by the doors there, and you can leave your donations on the way out. Please give generously. Please join in dedicating our offering with the words of affirmation.
With love at the center, the mission of this congregation is to inspire, connect, and act.
Thank you.
Our Easter prayer comes from the Reverend Paul Beadle. Let us contemplate the Spirit together. Spirit of life and love, justice and peace. 6 weeks ago, our Christian neighbors held their rite of ashes, and this past week they scattered palms from which next year's ashes will be made, and commemorated the death of the ancient leader whose ministry inspires their faith and traditions. Today they celebrate the story of a miracle, which is known as his victory over death, and is said to be the salvation of all people. They have been doing this now for thousands of years, at the season when the earth awakes from winter, the season of the flowers. Just as our Jewish neighbors at the same season celebrate a miracle of liberation from oppression, just as our neighbors of other faiths, Hindu, Buddhism, Jain, and more, celebrate the births of gods and the start of new years. Just as we each year celebrate the earth, our home. Come what may, O Spirit of Life, help us to see beyond belief to the goods and blessings and values that we, in our common humanity, use these symbols and remember. May we and our neighbors of all faiths also remember what binds us across our differences of custom and belief. May we see, beyond our common humanity, our common commitments. And may we together fill the world with love, understanding, and peace. In the Spirit, by the Spirit, with the Spirit, giving power, so may it be. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit to join in singing.
We'll be singing hymn number 78, Color and Fragrance.
You've given our chance to keep here seated.
Our closing words are adapted from a closing by Alex Holt. For all those who celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, may this day be an affirmation of divine love and promise. For all those who see the renewal of spring and life beginning anew, may you breathe deeply of a season of promise and hope. For all those who are feeling despair or hopelessness this Easter, may you find an opening to light and warmth that offers you freedom. For all of us, together we can do what no one isolated person can do. We are far more powerful than we could ever be on our own. Our offering of strong hands and minds to help together are prayers made real. Let us begin again in love, to love. Love and blessings to each of you. Blessed be. You're invited to close our time together by singing The Well. After our closing hymn, please hang on to your seats for a few announcements.
We drink from the well together, cool, cool water that quenches my thirst, a thirst for justice, a thirst for joy, a thirst for a love that we're all a part of. We drink from the well. We drink from the well together. Hand in hand we are standing as one, standing for justice, standing for joy, standing for love that we're all. We drink from the well together. Heart to heart, we are dancing as one. Dancing for justice, dancing for joy, dance for a love that we're all a part of. We drink from the well, spirits renewed. We drink from the well, stand hand in hand. We drink from the well. Dancing for joy, I feel my heart swell. We drink from the well.
If you're giving an announcement, come up. You know who you are. We're going to hear a lot of stuff, and there's a lot going on this morning, so don't forget about March Madness. We're in round four. I can tell you that, Dolphin beat Hummingbird by one vote. So your vote matters.
And thinking of votes matter, this year's vote really matters. So we have a program, as you know, to get out the vote. And just as a reminder, we have support from the Spirit Level Foundation and Chalice, and our goal is about 15,000 letters this year. That means that we have a lot of work ahead of us. That said, if everybody writes just two letters a day, each letter takes 2 to 3 minutes, you're talking 5 minutes a day, that will be about a little over 400 letters between now and Election Day. So this is not a major undertaking. So either see Susan or myself afterwards. We can provide you with letters and envelopes, but it's really important that we get busy getting letters out because that makes a big difference. Thanks.
I invite you to join the Imagining Liberation Leadership Team for a workshop on April 7th after the second service to discuss the final two characteristics of white supremacy culture as described by the work of Dr. Tima Okun. We will be discussing either denial and defensiveness or urgency, depending on the group's interest. And these last few weeks will be your final chance to join us and participate in the lively discussions and connect with fellow congregants around these very interesting topics. Thanks.
Okay, I'll make this as quick as I can. The city of Escondido is facing a financial crisis. The Escondido Citizens for Safety is proposing a 1 cent sales tax to address homelessness, repair local streets, increase emergency response capabilities, and continue services such as the California Center for the Art and the Escondido Library. There's no funding for the library at this time past the year 2026. It will close. If you are registered to vote in Escondido and you are interested in finding out more and or signing a petition to put the Escondido Community Investment Initiative on the ballot, please see me. I'm going to park myself in the fireside room, which if you don't know, it's the second door to your right as you go out. I'll open the door and leave the doors open. Thank you.
Okay, our social hour will begin in a few minutes online in this same Zoom link and in person on or about the courtyard, depending on what our spring rains are going to do for us here. Those of you here in person might want to take your refreshments into the green room today, since it might be, it's the green room, right? Yes.
Yeah.
We need to change.
Or any of the rooms.
Any of the rooms, what the heck. And have a visit with our online congregants. Reverend Sharon and I look forward to greeting you at the chapel doors to hear how the service was meaningful to you. Go in peace.